साइंस ट्रस्ट डे वार्षिक प्रमाणित നമ്മളുടെ ഡി പ്രേമാനന്ദിനെ അനുസ്മരിച്ചുകൊണ്ടുള്ള പ്രഭാഷണ പരിപാടിയും പൊതുസമ്മേളനവും ആരംഭിക്കുകയാണ്. ഈ സെഷനില് പങ്കെടുക്കുന്ന വിശിഷ്ട വ്യക്തികൾ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഏവർക്കും പരിചിതരാണ്. നമ്മുടെ മുഖ്യ അതിഥിയായി എത്തിയിട്ടുള്ള ലോക പ്രശസ്ത ചിന്തക ഡോക്ടർ മീര നന്ദ വേദിയിലുണ്ട്. അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഇന്റർനാഷണൽ ഹ്യൂമൻ സയന്റിഫിക്കൽ യൂണിയന്റെ എക്സിക്യൂട്ടീവ് ഡയറക്ടറായ ബാബു ഗോഗ്നേനി വേദിയിലുണ്ട്. ഫെഡറേഷൻ ഓഫ് ഇന്ത്യൻ റാഡിസ്റ്റ് അസോസിയേഷൻസിന്റെ പ്രസിഡന്റ് കൂടിയായിട്ടുള്ള ഡോക്ടർ നരേന്ദ്ര നായിക് ഉണ്ട്. റിച്ചാർഡ് ഡോക്കിൻസിന്റെ ഗോഡ് ഡെവല്യൂഷൻ എന്ന പുസ്തകത്തിന്റെ അടിസ്ഥാനമാക്കി നാസ്തികനായ ദൈവം എന്ന പുസ്തകത്തിലൂടെ അടുത്ത കാലത്ത് കേരളത്തിൽ വളരെയേറെ പ്രസക്തി നേടിയ പ്രൊഫസർ രവിചന്ദ്രൻ അദ്ദേഹവും ഈ വേദിയിലുണ്ട്. സ്വാഗത പ്രസംഗം എന്ന ഒരു ഉപചാരത്തിലേക്ക് ഞങ്ങൾ കടക്കുന്നില്ല. ഈ സെഷൻ ഉദ്ഘാടനം ചെയ്യാൻ നമ്മളെ കണ്ടിട്ടുള്ളത് ശ്രീ ബാബു ഗോഗ്നേനിയാണ്. അദ്ദേഹം ആന്ധ്രാപ്രദേശുകാരനാണ്. ലണ്ടൻ ആസ്ഥാനമാക്കിയാണ് IHEU ഡയറക്ടറായിട്ട് അദ്ദേഹം വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. നമ്മുടെ കഴിഞ്ഞ മാസത്തിലും അദ്ദേഹം പങ്കെടുത്തിരുന്നു. വളരെ മനോഹരമായ ഒരു പ്രഭാഷണം, ഒരു ക്ലാസ് അന്ന് അദ്ദേഹം നടത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ടായിരുന്നത്. കൂടുതൽ ഫോർമാലിറ്റികളിലേക്ക് കടക്കാതെ ഞാൻ അദ്ദേഹത്തെ ഈ സെഷൻ ഉദ്ഘാടനം ചെയ്തതായിട്ട് ക്ഷണിക്കുകയാണ്. ഐ ഇൻവൈറ്റ് ബാബു ഗോഗ്നേനി ഫ്രം ഇനാഗുറൽ.
Mr. Chairman and friends, it is indeed an honor and a privilege to be called on to inaugurate this session and to be able to remember the extraordinary services that Premanand has contributed to the advancement of scientific temper. What the Science Trust is all about. He was an atheist, but he was not known as an atheist. He was known more as a person who was advancing the scientific temper in our society. I think the greatest objection we should have is when superstitions and beliefs are used to abuse human rights, and that abuse is implemented through the agency of the state. I think it's a shame. For me, this is a fundamental human rights problem. Apart from the problem that while people have the freedom of belief, they should also have the freedom from make-believe. And the claim of the divine light appearing in the hills is make-believe, encouraged and perpetuated by people who see economic advantage in continuing this. Yes, there is freedom of religion. But we should also have freedom from religion, especially when that religion is fighting against the civilizational value of modern society. I think in the morning, in this very interesting open forum, the question was raised about whether our rationalism or scientific temper is Western or whether it is Indian. And I think a medical student also asked the question, what should I say to those who ask whether India has had a contribution to the scientific temper and to the enlightenment spirit? One is, of course, to give the factual answer that we had the Lokayata, the Charvaka, who contributed immensely, as Dr. Nanda pointed out, and more robustly than the Greeks themselves, to the materialist conception of the world. And it is also important to point out that the greatness of those people is not that some of their speculations might be close to modern science's conclusion. That is accidental. But the important point is several thousands of years ago, attempts were made to find answers to the problems of this world in the world itself. Find the answers to the questions about nature in nature and not in the supernatural. And that, I think, is a great thing that the Indians have done. Of course, there was no India then. That idea of India is more recent. But my question is, should I be worried by that challenge or that invitation to show that rationalism is homegrown? I submit that it is not necessary. What if rationalism had no origins in India, had no roots in India? So what? Nothing is foreign to us, that which is human. And if someone, somewhere in South America, or somewhere in China has discovered something, is it not a matter of pride for us? How can we compartmentalize our human identity on the line of political contours of nation? I think our loyalty has to rise above national identity. The one thing that scientific temper has taught us is the approach to truth. While religions have been claiming to have the eternal truth with them, science made never that claim. In fact, the enterprise of science is an enterprise of questions. It is the enterprise of religion, which is an enterprise of answer. Which is why we keep posing the questions repeatedly. And in the light of new knowledge, we are able to revise our conclusions about the universe. It is because they have been hanging on to their permanent answer that they become an obstacle to human growth and the development of civilization. This is an understanding of the scientific temper for most of us. As we look around us and we try to answer the kind of questions our medical student friend has been asked, there will be other answers to be given. They will say, if you have no religion, how can you be moral? What an interesting question. How can you be moral if you have no religion? The BBC did a survey 3 years or 4 years ago, a massive survey, and came to the conclusion that India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Nigeria but the most religious countries of the world. I don't know if Saudi Arabia was part of that list, as I clarified. India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Nigeria were the most religious countries of the world. They also are the most corrupt. They also have huge concentrations of crime. They are very low on any human rights index. And on the human development index, they are not anywhere near modern standards. I think that is an answer to the claim that religion gives us morality. In any of these countries, it has only worked against it rather than contributed to it. If you believe in your time and you refuse God, then how did this universe come about? They ask these questions with the confidence of those who think they have the answer. And in a 2-minute span, when they know they have no more answers to give, they will make the plea that we are hurting their religious sentiments. As if our sentiments are not hurt when lives are thrown at us in the name of miracles, in the name of false promises, and the threat that they show to us, asking us to accept their code of thinking and living. These are the kinds of daily challenges those of us who are active in the promotion of nationalism and humanism have to face. I was thinking that it was a great delicious irony this morning when I saw the news before coming to the meeting that the Karmapa is going to be investigated, questioned, interrogated by the police for a huge problem they had on their hands. The Karmapa office has been caught with nearly 7 crores of Indian rupees in foreign currency unaccounted for. Isn't it interesting? The paradigms of morality, breaking law, and amassing cash reserves of up to 7 crores of rupees in foreign currency in the country, in defiance of the law of the land. Last year, you had given me the opportunity to present to you some information about the wayward behavior and the dangerous stupidity of the Dalai Lama, and how the belief in rebirth of the Dalai Lama and of the Indian people was being misused by a coterie which no doubt has the full support of the Dalai Lama in promoting a child as possibly his successor and definitely as one with the powers of premonition and prediction. I'm happy to report to you that a few months ago, the Human Rights Commission of Andhra Pradesh, which is where we filed a petition, apart from a major public campaign involving all television studios, has ordered, and I can tell you for the first time in the world's jurisprudence, that the attribution of divine powers to a child was considered a crime by Justice Subhashan Reddy, who was, as you might remember, a Chief Justice of the Kerala High Court some years ago. Now, the Dalai Lama, of course, is a minor Buddhist leader, not what the public relations of the Dalai Lama would have us believe in. Of the 30 crore Buddhists in the world, only about 10 million happen to be of the Vajrayana kind of Buddhists, which is itself is split into four different schools. And the Dalai Lama really is the leader of the Gelugpa sect. And we have come in defense of the karma path today after he was caught and exposed for infringing the laws of the nation. Whatever their division, they are together. They are partners in crime usually. And that is what brings them together, protecting each other, defending each other. There is another sanctimonious fraud. A statement by whom is in today's Indian Express. Solitolaji writing about Mr. Berlusconi's sexual misadventure has quoted the Pope saying that people in authority should not abuse their position. Very well said, but it's the wrong person saying it. The Pope has been the one person, especially the present Pope, Ratzinger, a member at one time of Hitler's youth, the one who is the successor of the same body which condemned to death the great Giordano Bruno 400 years ago. That very great Pope was the one who was personally responsible for investigating into the crime being committed by Catholic priests all over the world when they were sexually abusing children in their care. And he systematically transferred those who were accused to countries with which Italy and many other European countries do not have extradition treaties. These are the ones who want us to learn morality from them. These are the ones who are telling us that they know something about the origin of the universe and how the universe functions. Some of these we encounter regularly on television. One of them, not too long ago, was discussing his astrological powers with us. They have 9 planets, and modern science has 9 planets. Give or take Pluto, but they have 9 planets, so does science have. So we have to challenge this man to name his 9 planets. Newton spoke of gravity. And they say that it is with those powers that those planets are able to influence our life. It is the moon which is creating the tidal waves in the ocean. So why can't it influence human beings? It's one of the wiser questions that those people have asked. When we ask them to name the 9 planets, they mentioned the sun, Ravi Graha. To start with, the sun is not a planet. It is a star. The second one they will mention is the moon. That is not even a planet. But at least it exists. What about Rahu and Ketu? They don't even exist. Then I asked this man why Ravi Graha was a Kshatriya Graha. Why Sukra was a Brahminical Graha. We didn't invent it, it's there in their book. And why the portent of evil, Shani, that beautiful planet, is a Shudra Graha. Because these fellows, after dividing humanity into the obnoxious classification of caste, have not even spared the universe of the existence and have given certain planets caste attributed them. And it is such a worldview that they were and are still trying to impose on us today. I think as a votary of science and the culture of science, I think our answers are very clear. If morality is to be learned, we should look for our moral instinct in our biological origin and in our long life in first in earth and then in society. And that is where we will learn our morality. As to the origins of the universe, we do not claim that we have the final answer, but we believe, and that is the strength of science, that we can come to certain tentative conclusions based on the knowledge that we have today. And as to how to organize society, we can certainly do away with their idea of how society should be organized. They might talk of the Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, having excluded 90% of human society from the very definition of humanity, and hence make them casteless, religionless, and treat them as animals. We need have no time for the religion to claim that they are for the brotherhood of humanity, forgetting at the same time that they do not stand for the sisterhood of humanity. We need not learn from them. I think the culture of science, the values that are reflected in the supreme law of this country, the Constitution of India, gives us enough basis to fight for that vision. Article 51 AH, which is about promotion of scientific temper, humanism, and the spirit of social reform, provides adequate basis for our social activism and also for our vision of what kind of society we seek and desire. The secular basis of India is in the preamble to the Constitution. It is true that both these things have been introduced into the Indian Constitution in manner that was dictatorial during a period when democracy was kicked out of Indian society. It is true that it is Mr. Gandhi's kitchen cabinet which introduced it. However, after Keshavananda Bharati case, which again has its origin in Kerala, we have the doctrine, the judicial doctrine of the basic structure of the Constitution. And after Gomaya case, secularism is accepted by a full bench of the Supreme Court of India as the start of the basic structure of Indian Constitution. If Parliament has disagreed, then what the sixth Parliament did could have been undone by any of the Parliaments since, and nothing of that kind has happened since 1976. So it is now well entrenched in the Indian political culture officially that secularism is a part of our Constitution and of our nation and of the state. Those of us who want a modern philosophy of life would seek that in the spirit of humanism. Humanism, which has the human at the center of all human endeavor, not God, and not transcendental value, if such can be called value. Those of us who seek a modern spirituality or morality are able to find it in the truth-seeking nature of time and its honest and moral method, which is open for correction ever, always, permanently correcting itself to approximate that truth, which is the content of knowledge. If we want a way of organizing our society, the values of human rights, the values of democracy, which put man man and woman, at the center of all human endeavors, provides that. We can live with this alternative, with this modern alternative to our traditional authoritarian, totalitarian ideas that people are still trying to impose onto us. People like Premanand and those who have come before him and after have been essentially moral beings, fired by moral anger at the dangers of belief in society, of unquestioned belief in society, and the growth of exploitation in the name of religion. Anywhere in India, you cannot escape the equality law provision unless the Devanagari board can say, it is because of my religious belief, it is because Swami Lord Ayyappa is a bachelor, that women cannot be allowed inside. Let us consider this question. My Lord and my God is a Brahmin. Therefore, Dalits are not allowed into the temple. How does that sound as an argument? You would be punished for putting forward such an argument when you deny the believer entry into the temple. I'm not talking of the Christian being given access to the temple, not of the atheist being given access to the temple. I'm talking of the believer being given access to that temple which is perpetually pursuing a religious pursuit. And human rights have to be a necessary companion to all talk about humanism, about rationalism, about scientific temper. After all, they are all based on that very basic claim that we have as humans, the right to think. Premanand continued his quest. Never stop thinking, and never stop questioning, and never stop challenging. I deem it a great pleasure to be able to inaugurate the session by recalling some of the ideas which have animated the life of the people of the kind that we admire as Mr. Premanand. And I think it is a great pleasure and privilege to have with us to deliver the lecture, the Premanand Memorial Lecture, by one of India's foremost academics on these issues. In an academic world that is rotting with the kinds of Ashish Nandi and the others, who in their misplaced nationalism, regionalism, localism, and in their misdirected anger are defeating science and truth itself. The postmodern menace has more or less, I think, dissipated in its virulence in the West, but it continues to have its hold and grip on Indian society. Because we will require a long time for ourselves to revise our view and ideas about the world. At the same time, we have a virulent, revitalized Orthodox religion which speaking the language of science and clothing the obnoxious ideas of their worldview in the shroud, the language of science. In that language, the work of Dr. Nanda has been most beautiful and most enlightening. So it gives me great pleasure that I have the opportunity also to listen to someone like her in this way.